So, last time we took notes on reproductive system, we talked about the structures of the male and female reproductive system, went over all the various parts and what they do. Today we'll talk a little bit more about pregnancy and the development of the embryo and birth and so on. So we're still kind of talking about the female reproductive system here. So what's the female sex hormone called? Males, we talked about testosterone. John? Yeah, estrogen. So the female sex hormone that's kind of the equivalent is estrogen. And it's produced, just like testosterone is produced in the testes, estrogen is produced in the ovaries. The ovaries also produce those egg cells. And the ovary itself, did we talk about this the other day? So the ovaries have all of the eggs that they're ever going to have at birth. Oh, we mentioned that? Yeah, okay. So the egg cells are immature. They're tiny little cells that are inside of the ovary. And then once every month or so after puberty, one of these eggs will mature. It'll start to grow and be released from the ovary. Okay. And what's that called?
Fertilization.
No?
No,
it was our question of the day the other day.
Ovulation.
So the release of the egg is called ovulation. And usually it's one egg gets released every reproductive cycle. So the female gamete is called an egg. So it's a pretty large cell. It's much larger than the sperm cell. It's released from the ovary. And then it starts traveling down the fallopian tube. And it's got takes a little while, moves pretty slowly, about a week or so, to make this journey through the fallopian tube. But if that egg cell is going to be fertilized, it's going to be fertilized here in the fallopian tube. The egg is not fertilized by the time it gets to the uterus, it won't be fertilized. It won't grow. So, in order for fertilization to happen, sperm cells, so during sex, sperm cells are deposited in the vagina. Those sperm cells then need to swim their way all the way through the cervix, through the uterus, through the fallopian tube, all the way to that egg cell in order to fertilize. It's a pretty long journey. A sperm cell is very, very tiny, and it's very long. That's why the sperm cells need nutrients from the semen. It's why they have that flagellum so that they can travel that path. They actually, the egg releases chemicals, and that's how the sperm cells kind of know where to go to reach the egg. And eventually, if one of them reaches the egg will then become fertilized, and then it can start to grow into the embryo. Did we mention the surgery a woman could have if she doesn't want to know that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. So if that sperm cell does get to that egg cell, then fertilization can happen. So when the sperm cell is carrying half of the chromosomes from the father, the egg cell has half of the chromosomes from the mother. If they combine, we have 46 chromosomes total, and that's the proper number for a human. And so we call that first cell that's formed a zygote. A zygote is just a fertilized egg cell. And even if several sperm cells reach the egg, only one of them will fertilize. As soon as one sperm cell penetrates the outer layer of the egg, there's like an instant change that makes it impermeable to any other sperm cells. So only one sperm cell can get into that egg.
No, it's not.
Oh, no. So if that zygote forms, if the egg cell is fertilized, the egg continues traveling through the fallopian tube. Eventually it gets into the uterus. And it will attach to the wall of the uterus. So as all this is going on, the release of the egg cell and other changes are all controlled by hormones. There's four main hormones that control ovulation and changes in the reproductive system in a woman. And that's what the reproductive cycle is. The menstrual cycle allows for this zygote to be fertilized and implant and start to grow. Because when a woman ovulates, what happens is the inside of the uterus starts to thicken, the lining of the uterus thickens, blood vessels grow there. What's happening is the body's getting ready for an embryo to implant there and start to grow. It's getting ready for a woman to become pregnant. If the egg is fertilized, it continues traveling down this fallopian tube, takes about a week, eventually gets into the uterus, the lining has been thickened, the embryo attaches to the wall of the uterus, and it stays there, and that's where it will grow throughout all of the pregnancy. But lots of times the egg isn't fertilized. There's no sperm cells to fertilize the egg after the woman ovulates. If that's the case, the egg doesn't get fertilized, it doesn't grow, it just continues into the uterus. And also the lining of the uterus is not needed anymore because there's no embryo there growing and attached. So if there's no fertilization, then the lining of the uterus starts to break down and is shed through the vagina. And that's what menstrual period is, the removal of that lining of the uterus. Because it's not needed. And then it will grow again the next month, getting ready for an embryo. If there's no embryo, again, it's shed. What's like one of the first signs a woman might know that she is possibly pregnant? Like what happens that sort of clues her in? Ava?
She misses her period.
Yeah, she doesn't get her period. And that should make sense because why isn't she getting her period?
Because her egg is fertilized.
And it's implanted. It's attached to the lining. So obviously, if the lining of the uterus were to break down, the embryo would not be there as well. It would break down. So the whole time a woman's pregnant, she doesn't get her period. And even after she has the baby for a while, she won't get her period because that lining is being used. It's not going to be shed. Yeah?
I forget what it's called, but what happens when like the baby dies?
Yeah, so sometimes we have different... So we have different terms for it. So we call it a miscarriage, usually. So miscarriage is when a woman knows she's pregnant, but then there can be various reasons. Sometimes the implantation doesn't happen properly. Sometimes there's genetic problems with the embryo and it just wasn't viable. It could happen for a whole host of reasons. It's called a miscarriage. And it's actually pretty common. A lot of women... may have had miscarriages in the past and maybe don't talk about it. So lots of people wait to tell people they are pregnant until after. The greatest risk of that is in the first trimester, they call it, the first 3 months of pregnancy. But it's actually pretty common. Lots of women go through this of getting pregnant but then having a miscarriage. Some women have several. I have friends that have had, you know, 4 or 5 or 6 miscarriages before they had a viable pregnancy. So it happens fairly frequently. Christian?
How does, can something happen inside there, your baby have autism or something from it?
Not because of that. There are different, diseases and different things like that can happen to the embryo, but not necessarily because of the development in the embryo. So they're just things that a person's born with. It's partially genetic, yeah. Yep. So if the egg's not fertilized, then the menstrual period happens. Okay? The lining wasn't needed because the woman didn't get pregnant and it gets shed. And then the whole process starts again the next month. And it will continue every month As a woman ovulates, her uterus gets ready to be pregnant. If she doesn't get pregnant, it's shed. Eventually, that whole process stops. Do you know what it's called, Julia?
Menopause.
So if you ever heard that term, menopause, okay, after a certain age, it depends. It varies from person to woman to woman. Middle-aged, you know, in the 40s, 50s, depends. Couldn't vary. But it means that reproductive cycle sort of stops. And then menstruation stops because a woman's no longer going to get pregnant. So this shows sort of that first week or so of pregnancy. And it shows the different stages along the way. So if we start here in the ovary, we have these tiny little cells. Those are the egg cells that a woman has in her ovary from birth. And then after puberty, again, once each month, usually one, of these eggs starts to grow and mature. It eventually makes its way to the edge of the ovary and kind of breaks open, releasing the egg into the fallopian tube. That's ovulation. Travels down, that's when it can be fertilized. If it is fertilized, it forms a zygote. And that zygote is one cell. But as it's traveling down the fallopian tube, it starts to divide and grow. It goes from one cell, and that one cell copies itself, and it's two cells. Okay? Then it's four cells and eight cells. And it starts to form a little ball of cells. Okay? By the time it's heading into the uterus, it's a little round ball of cells. It starts to become hollow. Okay? Different layers start to form. Eventually, it attaches to the wall of the uterus somewhere in the uterus. It can vary as to where it attaches. And that's where it's going to stay. It starts to grow into the wall of the uterus. And what do you think is going to form there? It's an organ we already talked about when we talked about mammals. We look back here. What is this organ? Yeah, the placenta. Where that embryo attached is where the placenta is going to form. And that embryo will stay attached for all of pregnancy. All right, just a kind of review here. We have just a sort of different viewpoint for the female reproductive organs. This is kind of the side view. The other diagram we labeled was the front view, where you can see two ovaries. This is showing the side. So you can just draw some lines here. We have the ovary. This is only showing one. Attached is the fallopian tube, which leads to the uterus. Opening of which, down here is the cervix. And then passageway out of the body is the vagina. Just in front of the uterus is the urinary bladder. The tube leading out of the bladder we know is the urethra. Pubic bone is a part of the pelvis. And then in the back we have the rectum, the end of the larger intestine.
Okay.
Sir,
That's how urine
comes out. Couple things. So when a woman is pregnant and a fetus is growing inside of the uterus, obviously the uterus can expand quite a bit as the fetus grows. And as this uterus expands and the fetus is growing inside of there, you could see it presses on the bladder. That's why, like, a woman when she's pregnant has to pee all the time, or she might say, she has to go to the bathroom because the baby's pushing on her bladder. Also, sometimes in the later stages of pregnancy, a woman has back pain a lot of times, because again, this fetus growing inside puts pressure on the spine and causes some strain there. So those things are all related there.
Wait, so is the cervix the womb?
No, when we say the womb, we mean the uterus, the inside of the uterus. Because when we say womb, it's basically where that fetus is growing. So just to review our anatomy here, I forgot what the order is here. So, raise your hand if you can name, raise your hand if you can name the parts. Starting here. Christian?
Testes.
Hold on, just one at a time. I think this is next. What do we call the big long tube that loops up, carries the sperm cell? Somebody else. Alex.
I don't know.
The surgery a man can have to permanently...
Oh, it's like where they chop off the...
They don't chop anything off.
I don't know.
Julia?
Vas deferens?
Oh, shoot. Forgot.
Yeah,
the scrotum on the outside, so that hold the testes away from the body, keep them cooler. Then we have the vas deferens. Eventually, it merges with what other tube?
Tiger redemption?
No.
Alex?
No. What? The urethra, the prostate and seminal vesicle add to the sperm to make semen, and then eventually out through the urethra, which runs through the penis. Starting with the female parts. Let's start here, I think. Julia?
Ovary.
Zach?
Fallopian tube.
I think that's next. Fallopian tube. Yep. Also called the oviduct. That's the word they used in ninth grade usually. Oviduct. But fallopian tube. Which leads then. I need some new hands here.
Uterus.
Yep, into the uterus. Good, John. Then out of the body. John?
Cervix?
Oh, yeah, the cervix isn't actually labeled there. Like, this would be the cervix.
Vagina.
This? Yep, vagina. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the embryo, the fetus, as it grows and develops. Talk sort of about pregnancy. So that zygote forms from a fertilized egg cell. It starts to divide. We start calling it an embryo as it's moving through these fallopian tubes. But fertilization happens in the fallopian tube. Takes about 6 days for the fertilized egg to reach the uterus. Where it will attach to the wall and start to form the placenta. So here we have a little diagram of a fetus. We have a placenta attached to the umbilical cord to the fetus.
Wait, is the implant to the uterus part of the placenta one or the uterus?
It's part of the uterus, yeah. It attaches to the wall of the uterus. So the placenta, if you remember back when we talked about mammals, is the organ in which nutrients and waste materials are transferred between the mother and the fetus. Oxygen, nutrients diffuse from the mother's blood into the blood of the fetus. And waste products from the fetus diffuse into the mother's blood so that she can get rid of them. That fetus will never eat or breathe or urinate until it's actually born. First breath that a baby takes is after it's born. Doesn't need to breathe when it's in the womb. Doesn't need to eat anything because it's getting all that through the placenta.
Doesn't it poop
outside here? No. Not usually. Sometimes during like the delivery process, it might, but not immediately. Oh, because it doesn't need to. It has nothing in its digestive system. It's not eating anything, so there's no waste that needs to be removed.
What's the delivery process? How is the umbilical cord, like, connected to the lungs?
To the lungs?
Like, how is it connected to the lungs?
It's connected, so there's basically, so you have the placenta, and it has filled with blood vessels from the fetus and from the mother, and then those blood vessels lead through the umbilical cord. The umbilical cord has arteries and veins that carry the blood from the circulatory system of the fetus to the placenta and back. So it goes in through the abdomen of the fetus and connects directly to the circulatory system. We'll talk in a minute about what happens after birth. So how long does it take from fertilization to a baby to be full term? How long does it take? Yeah, 9 months is like what people often say. The doctors usually will talk in terms of weeks. And really it's a little longer than 9 months. It's 40 weeks is like considered an average pregnancy. And anywhere from 38 weeks to 42 is a normal length of time for a pregnancy. Some women give birth a little before, a little after what the doctor says is their due date. Usually, if it's more than 2 weeks, if it's more than 42 weeks, the doctors will induce labor, make a woman start to have a baby using medications. If it's before 38 weeks, then what do we call a baby that's born before, Alexa? Yeah, preemie, sometimes a premature birth is when a woman gives birth to the baby before it's reached full development. And sometimes a premature baby has certain health issues because some of the organs have not fully formed and matured, and they have to get some special care at the hospital. Their lungs are one of the last organs that develop in the fetus, so often a premature baby, its lungs don't work as well as they should, and they can. There's lots of things doctors do to help them along. Yeah.
My friend, she's been through lots of issues, born super early, I can't remember, but I was just wondering, so when her mom started giving birth, the doctors gave her medicine and tried to stop it.
Yeah. Yeah, sometimes women go into what's called preterm labor. We'll talk about it in a minute, but normally a woman who's going to have the baby, she goes into labor, and she's going to be having the baby. Well, some women, that starts to happen too early. It might happen at 36 or 34 or 30 weeks even, and that's early because the baby's not fully mature yet. So what the doctors, they don't want a woman to have a premature birth if they can avoid it. So there's sometimes medicines they can give to slow down labor and maybe stop it. Usually, a woman that's having it, they'll put them on bed rest, which means they just have to lay in bed, because the more active might encourage labor to happen faster, so they put a woman on bed rest maybe, so she just sort of relaxes and tries to do as little as possible so she can continue for the baby, that's the fetus inside of her, to continue to develop and mature, and she could try and have it at the normal time. But sometimes it just happens. Sometimes a woman goes into labor early and the doctors can't do anything to avoid it, and she has the baby early, and then the baby will need certain treatments. Sometimes they need to be put on a ventilator to help them to breathe. They need to be cared for. Sometimes they're really small, they have to be fed a special diet. So in past, several years, they've been able to really help along babies that are quite premature compared to what they used to be able to do. Christian?
My sister was born 1 month early.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
And she got put in this box, mm-hmm. And no one could touch her.
Yeah, they're usually, they keep them, they need to keep them warm and keep everything. They have monitors to monitor their heart rate. Yeah. And they usually have oxygen and sometimes a ventilator to help them to breathe. So yeah, they have special care. It's called a neonatal unit for special care for newborns. So we use these terms, and so just to define them, a zygote is just the one cell, a fertilized egg cell. After it starts to divide, we call it an embryo until it reaches the 8-week point. And then from 8 weeks until birth, we call it a fetus. So the fetus is like a later stage of the embryo. There's different names we get. So if we look at sort of what it looks like during the development of
Eight weeks to birth.
So if we look at the inside, this is obviously further along. This is a fetus. And let's label these parts so you can recognize some. Now this is not showing the whole part, but what is this up here? Raise your hand if you could tell.
Oh. Right. Damn, it's enough with your ooh and ah.
John? Yeah, that's the top of the fallopian tube. It would continue to the ovary. And then this whole sort of thing that holds the developing fetus and everything. What does this line show? Julia?
Uterus?
Yeah, that's the uterus. The whole thing is the uterus. The uterus is a muscle. It's like a pouch-like muscle that can expand and shrink back down. Attached to the wall of the uterus, this organ here, that's the placenta. And you can see it's got blood vessels in it. Attaching that?
Umbilical cord.
Raise your hand, please. Alex?
Umbilical cord.
Is the umbilical cord. Just got blood vessels in it. Now, we haven't talked about this yet, but enclosed in the uterus, there is a membrane around the embryo and fetus. You can see it here, and it's filled with fluid. Okay. It's called the amniotic sac. The fluid inside is called amniotic fluid. And it helps sort of protect the fetus from any bacteria and things that might be in the womb. It cushions the fetus, so it's not just like bouncing around inside the uterus. It's in a nice little bubble of this warm amniotic fluid. And it's okay that it's in this liquid because it doesn't need to breathe. Right? It's getting its oxygen through the placenta. Let's just finish that and I'll answer your questions. We have the fetus, and then the opening of the uterus is the cervix. So the amniotic sac is the fluid-filled sac that helps protect.
Whoa, what is that?
That's not an actual picture, I don't think. That is a computer generated, but it shows what it might look like in the womb. You could see the fetus, you could see the umbilical cord, you could see the placenta over here. So, Julie, you have a question?
So for twins, how would like the placenta and like umbilical cord work?
So sometimes twins have a single placenta and two umbilical cords. Other times there are two placenta forms. And sometimes twins share an amniotic sac. Sometimes they have two amniotic sacs. Sort of depends on how they implant. It's tight in there. And usually twins are smaller. Like if you had one baby, you know, might be a certain size in terms of pounds, you know, whatever, 6 to 8, 9 pounds. If you have twins, usually each one is a little bit small on the smaller side. So this amniotic, so how does a woman know she's gonna probably be having the baby? She's pregnant, she knows she's having a baby sometime in the next couple weeks. What's like something that happens that she says, oh, I'm gonna be having this baby like today? Julia?
Attractions.
Yeah, and sometimes even before this. Giada? What's that? Cat? Yeah, when she, her water breaks. That's a term maybe you've heard. What happens is this, when the baby's about ready to be born and she's about to go into what we call labor, having the baby, this amniotic sac breaks. Usually, not always, but usually. And the amniotic fluid inside leaks out. And so comes out through the cervix, through the vagina. And so that is a sign this woman's going to be having the baby soon. Usually labor starts around that same time or soon after. And if it doesn't, the doctors want her to have the baby like within 24 hours. Like if her water broke and she hasn't gone into labor in 24 hours, the doctors will induce her, make her go into labor. Because once that amniotic sac is broken, it's possible bacteria can enter and could cause an infection. So they want her to have the baby relatively soon after. And so, yeah, you said contractions. A contraction, just like you could like contract your bicep muscle, the uterus is a muscle, and it squeezes, it contracts. And what it's doing is starting to move the fetus. As it contracts, contractions start off mild. You can feel them, and they're spaced out. But as labor's going along, they become more intense and stronger, and they happen more quickly, and they get closer together. As this fetus is being moved through the uterus and moved down lower, the cervix is normally completely closed throughout pregnancy, but it starts to dilate to allow the fetus to come out. If you ever heard of one in movies or whatever, they talk about she's 5 centimeters dilated or 6. They're measuring how open the cervix is, because once it gets to full dilation, like 10 centimeters, that's when the fetus can start to move out. And so contractions move, open up the cervix, start moving the fetus out, comes out head first usually is the normal way. And then eventually she has to push the baby out, okay, and that's delivery. She has to actually use muscles and push the baby out. It's born through the vagina, head first usually, and then the shoulders come out, sort of turns halfway. I'll show you what it looks like next week.
Have a good weekend. Don't play too much Fortnite.